matter, of course.
Yeah, oh, it's coming.
Yeah, they're making copies okay. now.
All right, we're going to do the Pledge of Allegiance.
Okay. Okay.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Good evening, everybody.
Good evening.
We're here for round two of our...
Three,
excuse me. I'm so ecstatic, I'm losing count. of the zoning rewrite review. If I'm correct, Mr. Fine, we're taking up where we left off last time with a couple of...
We are, Mr. Chairman. Would you like me to begin?
And if you'd like to proceed, you may proceed.
Thank you for coming out tonight. We are indeed going to pick up where we left off at our last meeting, which was on January 7th. So tonight's agenda, we'll have a brief recap of our last two meetings, and we'll pick up, like you said, where we left off with the suburban industrial districts, district changes, recreation and conservation changes, and then we're going to get into our overlay districts, which are riparian buffer conservation district, floodplain, land preservation overlay, and steep slope. We'll talk about our sign ordinance changes and parking and transportation. At our December 4th, 2014 meeting, which was our first meeting in front of the Planning Commission, we dealt with the Planning Commission's role, zoning map changes, definition changes and additions, use regulations, changes and additions. We discussed our residential districts, and we also talked about the apartment office AO district changes. At the Planning Commission meeting on January 7th, we reviewed the community service district changes, Main Street, which are small commercial districts, MSL, MSN, MSW, that should be read. I mean, MSH, that should read, excuse me. MSVC district. And we reviewed the business center district, which replaces our planned business district. So tonight we're going to begin with the suburban industrial district. We have very few locations in the township. This is a this is an older zoning district for the township and has become somewhat underutilized, and we've seen some various changes occur, mainly the Switchville development on Highland Avenue in Glenside. And some of the proposed changes for the SI district mimic those ideas that were in the overlay district that was used for the Switchville crossing development. Great. So we designated three different areas and two sub-districts of the suburban industrial. So you have the two areas in Glenside. The one is the one we just talked about, which is the Switchville area and SPS, Standard Press Steel Factory. Those are in the SIG district, which is for Glenside, and then there's a very small sliver, and you'll see the maps in a second, on Tyson Avenue, just off of Mount Carmel. And then we have our area near the mall, which is across from the trolley stop shopping center, which is the Willow Grove SI district. We wanted to reinvent these areas to allow greater uses, complement the surrounding areas, and also identify and also recognize the fact that the township, due to its location, its lack of arterial roads and highways, that industrial, pure industrial development in the township is probably not in our future. And we also want to encourage adaptive reuse, and mainly that stems towards looking at SPS Steel and some of the larger buildings that are in the Willow Grove district, where you have older factories that have the ability to be adapted to some of the new uses. So this is our Glenside area, the biggest of the Glenside areas, and you'll note that this is where the Switchville crossing development happens. This is Highland Avenue, Jenkintown Road. Larry's house is right here. This is SPS steel, and then you come outside the township line.
Shouldn't we have rezoned up that road to Larry's house?
Oh, it is.
Okay.
It is.
Don't worry about it.
It is. It's rezoned for an insane asylum. They won't even have to change the building.
Khaki, are you listening to this?
All right. That's me.
Thank you, hon.
We have another area in Glenside. It's a very small sliver. This green area that you see here is Pembroke Park. You have Mount Carmel Avenue running up here, and Tyson, the train tracks run right behind this and up along here. You actually can't see most of these properties from the street because there's houses in front of this small sliver of SI district that are usually just accessed through private access ways. It's a very hard area to see. And back there is a lot of contractors, storage areas, not much hope for redevelopment or bringing any assets to the township, but it's something we needed to pick up here. So once again, to describe this chart that you're seeing here, if it's in red, it's a change. If it's in red and it's crossed out, it's a change, meaning that the use has been eliminated from the category that it's in. So because this is a change from pure suburban industrial, and you'll see most of these black uses, retail shop, assembly plant, contractor shop, distribution center, and so on and so forth, are pure industrial uses. Most of the uses that we're adding mimic similar uses that we have in the suburban industrial mixed development overlay district that was developed for the Switchville. And using that model, we took those uses and started adding them to the suburban industrial Glenside area. So you'll see some of those similar uses, bank, dry cleaners, farmers market. There are school, restaurants, self-storage areas. We added some of the uses that were obligated to add as per state law. The quarry is one of them. And we also added in other areas that will complement some of these areas, some of these locations in the township through some elderly housing like life care facilities and such. Some additional uses, we add in residential uses. So to complement the mixed use aspect of the SI districts that were the changes to the SI district. And you'll see some professional offices, commercial spaces that are allowable, and then some of our community service uses that are allowable, performing arts centers, studios, so on. We have accessory uses that are common with the list of uses you just saw. The one that we're taking out is a commercial accessory apartment. That's no longer needed because we have actual residential uses on the property allowable now. We have our no-impact home-based businesses, which is required. We go to our special exception uses. Special exceptions are some of the more intense uses that we would see. Car wash, veterinary clinic, daycare centers as part of a mixed-use building, group homes, and then a small movie theater. And that's primarily because of the size of the properties that are currently in this area. For the exception of SPS, most of the properties are not very large, and the parking requirements for a large movie theater are probably unlikely. And then we go to our conditional use, which is an office campus, which would be multiple buildings for office. SPS actually could fall into that location, and the primary reason why an office campus was put in as a conditional use so that the board and the township would have a greater say in what would occur there on an adaptive reuse of SPS. So you'll see my new and improved dimensional slides, and you can actually read them this time.
We express our appreciation. Thank
you. So I'm going to go through. You'll see in the first column is the SI existing. Then you have your SIMD overlay district, which is the, as I said, the zoning district that was created for the Switchville area. And then you have your two others that are the SIG district, the one in Glenside and the one backs up to Pembroke, and that's on Tyson. And then SIW, which is the Willow Grove. And you'll note the comments on the right-hand side, which get into a little bit more specific of some of the uses or some of the dimensional requirements. The density allowable would be 10 units 10 dwelling units per acre. The minimum tract size is 4 acres. Larry, how big is this Switchville property, this tract area? Do you remember?
Six acres.
Thank you, Glenn.
Thank you.
Right behind you.
So the minimum lot area or the tract minimum for the Glenside area is 4 acres, and then once you get into the SIW district, it goes into a more traditional dimensional requirement of 1 acre minimum. You have lot widths, which are somewhat similar, lot depths, which are somewhat similar, or actually not somewhat similar, but they actually match the layouts of the properties within those districts. You have front yard setbacks. We also have special setbacks that relate to a residential zoning district on the side column here. Go on to the next one. We have a building maximum on the SI district and the SIMD overlay district. It was 50%. And what we found through the help of the Montgomery County Planning Commission is most of these properties actually already have buildings that are exceed that 50% mark. So we changed in an effort to support the adaptive reuse aspect and trying to spur on the adaptive reuse, we make the allowable building maximum footprint to be larger than the 50%, which was in the zoning ordinance now, because that actually reflects more of what reality is out in the site. The SIMD overlay district allowed for 80%. The original SI district had 75%. We're allowing 80%. And once again, I will also point to the fact that most of the properties, if not all of the properties that exist in the SI district, are probably well over 90% in impervious coverage. We have a green area, which is similar across the board, or in proportion across the board. We have different height requirements, and we use that different height requirement based on the uses as were laid out in the SIMD ordinance. 55 feet for the first list of uses, offices, medical clinic, medical office. 45 feet for an athletic club and indoor recreation, and all others would be 35 feet. Mm-hmm. We have a maximum building length, which is consistent all the way across from the existing to the new. And we have a minimum building separation of 35 feet unless it's a building to a parking garage, and then it can be reduced to 25 feet. In the SIW district, you would see that we have two small areas. We have this location here. The mall is this red area that you see creeping out on the left-hand side. This is Davisville Road, and the trolley stop is where the word Davisville is actually sitting. This is that section, I think it's fast by Farachi and right south of where the dollar store was or is. There's an area of SI there. And then we have this location. This is Rockwell Avenue. Rockwell ties into Old Welsh, the Boston Market on Old York Road. It's right in this location. And you have a series of buildings along Rockwell which are currently zoned SI, and that would be SIW. Recognizing the location of the SIW districts, we have somewhat eliminated most of, if not all of, the industrial uses for these properties as allowable uses, because specifically the uses near the mall or the properties near the mall, it would, from a planning standpoint for the township, it would be better served being more of commercial uses than they would be industrial uses. And that's the reason why we made the decision in the SI district to eliminate most of those industrial uses. What's up, Bruce? You'll have similar commercial uses. We did add some in there that we did not have in the other one, specifically like the hotel, being that it's close to a commercial area, closer to Willow Grove, the Willow Grove interchange for the turnpike. We felt that that was a good location to add in the ability to have a hotel or motel or inn. continuing on, these are very similar to the other. We also add in this case, a place of worship, class 3. We have the accessory uses, once again, are mimic the same as the SIG district.
Bless you.
Bless you.
Special exception, very similar to the SIG district. And then we have no conditional uses in the SIW district. Same dimensional chart, no differences as we reviewed both of those columns in reviewing the SIG district. So some of the design standards, vehicular access, there should be a maximum of one vehicular access point per 200 feet for frontage. No more than two vehicle access points shall be permitted per frontage. Once again, that goes back to our original ideas from the first meeting that we had, which was to limit curb cuts on streets to allow for smoother traffic patterns. Loading areas, we have design standards set up for those. Building orientation, buildings abutting Davisville Road, Jenkintown Road, and Highland Avenue shall face those roads, which means those primary facades should present themselves to those three streets. Once again, giving back to those commercial areas in those specific areas of the township. We're looking for a phasing plan because in some cases, if there's assemblage of property or if the property is on a larger scale and similar to what's happening with Switchville, that we get a phasing plan as to what the plan, what the developer's schedule is and how long they think that the plan will actually take to be implemented. As we've seen with Switchville, one piece got built and there was no real specific idea as to when the other pieces were going to be filled in. So the phasing plan allows the township to have some control and also put in some dates that the township can actually start to react if things change along the way. Parking in the SIW suburban industrial area, when parking for uses on Davisville Road lie between the street and the principal building, well, we go back to our street wall requirement. And that's once again recognizing that you have the trolley stop and the idea that even with the business center district that's happening and the Main Street district of the trolley stop, that we're looking to get more of a pedestrian type set up, and that street wall in that specific area would complement the Main Street district that's in that trolley stop area. And that completes the suburban industrial changes, and we're open to taking questions at this time, Mr. Chairman.
Any comments or questions from us? We're pretty familiar with this, having put through it back at Switchville, which was not all that long ago. Any comments or quick concerns? I think let's go on to the next section.
So now we're going to move on to our overlay districts. Recreation and Conservation District. And this is only two slides here, which is a change for us. Dimensional changes, the main thing here is any clubs, private recreation, or active recreation shall have at least 100-foot setback from any property line. That's in recognition of trying to make sure that any buildings, areas that may create congregation of a group of people is as far away, because a lot of these conservation or RC district properties are abutting or surrounded by residential neighborhoods. And by creating that 100-foot setback, it pulls that further away from those areas. So, and that concludes the changes to the RC district. Are there any questions on that, or should I move on?
Go ahead. Sorry.
In Article 8, RC Recreation Conservation District, page 69 of the existing or the proposed zoning ordinance, section 1300 is intent, and then section 1301 are uses specifically prohibited. It just seems like there's something missing, like we need to indicate what's permitted. I know that's in the matrix as well. All the other zoning districts indicated permitted uses, and just the wording, in addition to uses prohibited in the use matrix, and the following uses shall, the following uses are also specifically prohibited. Accessory uses involving business operations except as permitted herein. I think that's a little confusing. And signs except, like we're saying, it's not clear to me as a, if I had to do this, I don't know, a zoning permit in here of what actually is permitted versus specifically prohibited.
Okay. I think that's a, Mark, that's a carryover from the original ordinance.
It was, yes.
Give us a second.
Yeah.
We do understand. I think we actually, there were some other points of the old ordinance where it did talk about specifically prohibited uses, and I think we actually discussed that during our meetings, was to get rid of some of those things.
Yeah, I guess maybe if, you know, section 1301 could be, say, use regulations, and then how you have it in the other chapters, like a building or whatever can be used, see figure A1 matrix or something like that.
The answer to your question is yes, it's a direct carryover from the other ordinance. Once you got by accessory uses, you know, the list of four that
Mark, could you pull my calendar, please?
Yeah, it is a carryover from the prior, from the current zoning ordinance. 500.2A6 is where you see that language in the current ordinance, and then it does list specific ancillary uses. So
We'll take that under advisement. I think we actually had this conversation with our prior solicitor, was to not have some confusion in there and list prohibited uses and just list allowable uses, special exceptions, and conditional uses. So we'll take that down. Thank you.
Okay. Then in subsection C, where it talks about the Open Space Protection Plan 2006 reference, right above that.
Yes, I see it.
Just or as amended, maybe some kind of language, because I'm assuming that will be updated.
Okay.
Thank you.
I didn't get that. What was that?
She just wants to, in under intent.
C, regarding the Open Space Rec and Environmental Protection Plan of 2006, just put, continue the sentence, or as amended, or revised, yeah, or some kind of language when it's updated.
Something to secure it in perpetuity.
Yeah.
Understood.
Gotcha. Any other comments, concerns? Public? Ms. Lehman?
So on the recreation use, when we have something like Memorial Field that's already in there, and not necessarily even in this zoning, I don't know what zoning that is. But when we did Memorial Field, did we leave a 100-foot buffer there?
Memorial Field, is that?
I don't.
Memorial Field is the one on Huntington Road.
On Huntington.
On Huntington Road,
yeah.
The old ghost.
That's what
field.
I think it was. I forget.
Is there a 100-foot buffer there?
From the building, for a building that's on there.
Well,
I don't know. I'd have to go back and scale the plan.
I have to look at the plan.
Okay, and the other thing.
And besides, that work was approved without this ordinance being adopted.
What's that? I missed that.
That work and that project was approved. This ordinance has not been adopted at this point.
It's not necessarily related to the zoning or anything. I just wondered if it.
Well, then I would suggest that question be sent to Mr. Penicow or Mr. Matteo, and they can answer that question.
We'll look at this. Yeah.
Okay. So, and the other thing I wanted to ask is, back in the suburban industrial district, could you bring up a couple of the places where a hotel would be available to use? It's by right, right?
It is a by right
I
use.
Missed that. We went there. So you put it by right. We had that conversation last time about the fact that by right could create some serious problems. So could you show some of the places that a hotel, motel?
Well, I believe the serious problems was a comment that you made. I'm not sure that that's something that the Zoning Ordinance Committee agrees with. So I'll bring up the areas. The SIW district, which is this section here across from the mall. This is Davisville Road.
Right, okay, and that has a train track and a road in front of it, and so that might be a good place.
And then you have a small section on Rockwell Avenue, which is allowable for a hotel, but the reality is none of these properties would support a hotel.
Okay, and it wouldn't support a hotel?
There are lot sizes, required space for parking. They just are not conducive to supporting the dimensional requirements for a hotel.
But if somebody bought two of them or three of them, they might, right?
I think in our test fits, we would find that those properties would almost eliminate the possibility of a hotel.
Okay, and somewhere else, anywhere else?
That's it, just in the SIW. The SIG district does not have a hotel allowable.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. Any other questions on, or should we move on?
Set. Let me go ahead.
Okay. So we're going to move on to our overlay districts. It's not even 7:30. I just want it noted for the record that we're already on agenda number 4.
Don't tempt fate, okay?
Let's not jinx it.
So this is, we're going to deal with our overlay districts. There are primarily 4 major overlay districts in the township that we dealt with here. The first one is our riparian corridor conservation district, and this was drafted with a lot of assistance from the Environmental Advisory Council and Montgomery County Planning Commission. This was one of those ordinances that was developed in one of our subcommittees that was created as part of the Zoning Ordinance Committee. And this is a, and as you can see, there's the intents are up here, is to really fortify and save our waterways through the township, strengthen erosion control, improve and maintain the safety, reliability, and adequacy of the water supply, the plantings along there, pesticides going in, so on and so forth, and you can see those intents listed up here. So the way the riparian corridor conservation district, and this is an overlay that infects basically the entire township, but zeroes in on any area that has a riparian buffer. Minimum property size applies to properties of at least 1 acre that lie partially or wholly within a riparian corridor. And we'll show you the map of the riparian corridor in a few minutes. And that's one of the inserts on your zoning book. Corridor width shall extend a minimum of 75 feet from a defined edge waterway or bank full flow. And those things are defined within the district itself. You have 2 zones. There's zone 1 that begins at the edge of the waterway and occupies land within minimum width of 25 feet. Adjustments may extend zone 1 further than 25 feet where steep slopes and woodlands exist. The ordinance goes further in describing how that occurs. Zone 2 takes you out to 50 feet, and then with adjustments for floodplain, where the 100-year floodplain extends greater than 75 feet from the waterway, zone 2 shall extend to the outer edge. So zone 2 is somewhat flexible depending on the designation of the 100-year floodplain. And this is a map that shows, so you have your waterway, you have your first 25 feet, which is in zone 1, and then you have your next 50 feet, which is in zone 2. And the point that was made that is if the 100-year floodplain extended outside of zone 2, zone 2 would extend to reach that 100-year floodplain.
Stephen, can you clarify, Don?
Sorry.
Can you clarify what bank full means? Bank full flow?
I'll give that to Michael.
Yeah, let me look that up. Thank you.
Basically, you're saying define edge of waterway at bank full flow. So
right. My understanding is that it's when the water body has risen to the top of the bank on either side.
To basically. The obvious edge of whatever it is. Okay.
Right.
Some aren't so obvious. Okay.
That's right. If you were to look.
Well, for, I mean,
if you were to look at a typical section of a waterway, there would be at some point, due to the vegetation and the erosion on the long on along the side of the, you would see the normal bank creation
top.
From okay. from the stream or from the waterway, and that would be considered the bankfall. It is a bit subjective, but it is somewhat clear also. I mean, you're going to be within a few feet. It's not like there's a question of 20 right. or 50 feet. It's usually a question of 1 or 2 feet.
And that doesn't vary either as a result of a particular condition, storm or water intensity that's coming down in any particular season. So the waterfall would be relatively constant throughout
the fall. It's typical to look at a stream bank and you'll notice the regular erosion from the bank full location. There's obvious areas where you might see some additional erosion that may have occurred from a larger rainfall or from a flood of some sort, but you can differentiate between the two different erosion.
There's generally a significant break in the slope. You have a fairly steep slope adjacent to the stream, and then it flattens out when you're up on the flood. So it's pretty easy to determine by looking at it.
Yes, my understanding is that it's a fairly common term. We didn't actually define it in the ordinance, but it was with that understanding and just looking it up. The term bankfall refers to the water level stays that just begins to spill out of the channel into the floodplain.
Okay. And why would the woodlands, in addition to the to a steep slope, why would woodlands allow a greater edge? The adjustments may extend the zone one farther than 25 feet when steep slopes and woodlands exist. Is it and or?
Let me see here.
The way it's written right now, it's and.
Okay.
Mark, you want to use the...
I'm waiting on you to come up with
your
definition for it.
Right. Let me find that diagram there. Okay. We're flipping. Okay. So it covers extensions for the floodplain and the steep slope. Where do you see the part about the woodlands?
Just in okay. zone one.
Zone one. Okay, gotcha. Gotcha. Okay.
Yeah, the 25 feet where steep slope mm-hmm. and woodlands exist.
Right.
Details determine this are in the ordinance.
Right. I mean, the actual, and again, this is a summary. The actual ordinance is... this zone shall begin at each edge of an identified waterway, may be required to extend beyond the minimum 25 feet upon existing topography, woodlands, and other natural conditions. The township engineer makes that determination. So there's a level of discretion there granted the township engineer. The only thing specifically written in to the ordinance is the steep slopes. So whenever there's steep slopes of 25% or greater, you extend it.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
Any other comments, concerns?
I assume this is consistent with the stormwater management stuff that we passed.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, this is based on the model from the county, which is consistent with FEMA. So there's been a whole lot of coordination going on.
Great. I'm going to continue on.
Please,
we'll
sorry,
have
yes.
another time for questions on the riparians. So you'll see this map. It's not going to show up great here, but this is a map of the township. It has a key here. This is also part of the ordinance. It's an insert in the back of the ordinance, and it's also in the riparian section in a smaller scale, but this shows all our riparian areas within the township. So our permitted uses it shall be mitigated by riparian management provisions in zone one. By right uses are passive open space residential lots up to half of any required yard setback, and in conditional uses are corridor crossings by roadways and driveways. So if somebody were to come in and wants to cross a riparian area on a residential property, they would need to come in for a conditional use hearing with the township, with the Board of Commissioners. In zone two, you have similar, you have the by rights or passive open space, and then we give up some additionals because we are further away from the bankful. You have your pervious trails and reforestation efforts. Conditional uses would also be our crossings. We add in here utility lines and then naturalized stormwater management areas and passive recreation spaces. And then we have a list of prohibited uses. Some of those are specific to zones. Our first one is building and permanent structures, with the exception of specified recreation uses. So basically, nothing is going to be built that's going to impede the water flow in those Zone 1 and Zone 2. Zone 1 required yards of mixed use and non-residential lots are at least half the required front, rear, and side yard of residential lots. Talks about specifics there. We have roadways, parking lots are prohibited, clear cutting of vegetation, storage of hazardous and noxious materials, use of fertilizers, subsurface sewage disposal areas, and stormwater basins. Nonconformities, we deal with that since we have a slew of nonconformities within our riparian areas as they exist now. Uses and building footprints may not be expanded, so there are quite a few locations in the township where people have accessory structures that would sit within one of these zones. They're allowed to stay, but they can't be expanded upon. And riparian management goes on to talk about that and refers back to the SALDO, which is our subdivision and land development ordinance. And that completes the review of the riparian corridor conservation district. So I'll take any additional questions along those lines.
Just one question. For the permitted uses that you just went over, do you also need 1 acre for those to kick in? I know you have it on your sheet about minimum property size, 1 acre, but I'm not quite sure where that is in the ordinance under Article 15, page 97, et cetera. I thought I saw it somewhere, but I am getting new glasses, so I can't see as well right now. So I just wanted to see if what you just went over would apply to also the lots that are less than an acre or not in those districts.
Okay, the acreage is listed in 1502A, so just under the establishment and width determination.
Okay, it applies to properties at least 1 acre. So then section 1503, you'd also have an acre lot for, like, say, a residential lot area, up to half of the required yard setback area for any individual lot. So that would only apply to acre or larger residential lot? No?
No.
I see Mark shaking his head.
No, the way I read this, Kathy, and I think I know where you're going with this, if you take a look at our neighborhood, and specifically like Ferndale or Anzac, the way I read this or the way I think it would be enforced, if it's still me, remember this is a floating setback at this point. Okay. It's 25 feet or 100% of the 100-year floodplain. So in our neighborhood where we have 5,000 square foot lots, 7,500 square foot lots, that run of Barnes and Westmont and Anzac and Fernwood, where all those floodplain properties are, the majority of them are 50% or more within the limits of the 100-year floodplain.
Okay.
So that, and I'll use my property as an example on Brookdale. I have 25 foot of the rear yard of my property is within the limits of the 100-year floodplain. But in the one corner, that distance, as I said, 25%, the lot's 289 feet deep. So that's, you know, it's almost 60 feet worth of depth that is going to be in that riparian corridor.
Right, because of how this it slopes, right?
Well, I mean, behind me I have the improved portion of the stream with the gabion walls, but then as you come from the center of that stream, at its shortest point it's 37 feet, at its deepest point it's 68 feet until you're out of the floodplain. So by reading this, that riparian corridor then my lot's just over 14,000 square feet, it would be an odd-shaped riparian buffer, but it would be 68 feet deep into one corner of my property, 38 or so feet deep in the other.
Okay, that's, okay, I just wanted to make sure that...
My concern with this and the way this looks is if you take an area like Roslyn Park, where 100% of Roslyn Park is within the limits of the 100-year floodplain, to include those homes that front on Anzac, that riparian buffer actually extends across Fernwood and Anzac and into the front yard of the properties across the street. So that's something we may have to look at and define, you know. That may fall under the discretion of the township engineer.
Okay.
As to how much of that has to remain planted riparian buffer and how much of it can remain, you know, active sports fields. No increase in impervious coverage or stormwater runoff, but still
right. It's
cut lawn, not the plantings that you would see in your riparian buffer.
Okay, thank
but
you.
There is a parking lot on Roslyn Park, right? And it's a prohibited use.
Four of them.
Yeah.
They're existing non-conforming improvements. I mean,
okay. Mm-hmm.
There's a clubhouse there. There's a concession stand. There's bathrooms there. There are tennis courts, a skate park. Yeah. We're missing basketball parks, children's play equipment.
That's all non-conforming under this ordinance.
Correct.
Yeah. I have another question. Why are stormwater basins prohibited uses? I would think that they might be, you know, they're certainly very useful for flood control, knocking the tops off of hydrographs. So I don't understand why that's listed under a prohibited use.
I think the thinking behind that is stormwater management facilities usually operate in where they can actually be, where the water that's collected can be absorbed. The closer you get to a stream bank, the more saturated the ground is, and the less ability for that water to be saturated or to be absorbed into the ground. So the idea behind that is to effectively allow the stormwater management facilities to work properly, as they are, so that they're further away from the stream banks.
Yeah, but I mean, you don't necessarily have to have infiltration to knock the peak off of a hydrograph. You can temporarily retain the water and then release it slowly. And that, in my mind, would be a stormwater basin that could be, be beneficial.
Wouldn't that be a retention basin? Though?
Yeah,
sure.
Is a stormwater basin, though.
Not sure. It's not, I mean, it's probably not the worst possible use you could have there, and certainly it would help retain water. But part of the point of the riparian buffer is to have a natural corridor, so you have the filtration, and the water does flow into the stream, but it's filtered, and you have plants with root systems and in a as dense as possible vegetation corridor to take up that water to filter the runoff, to filter the nutrients. So with a retention basin, you're clearing some of that. You're also cutting into a potential wildlife corridor. So I'm sorry.
Maybe what you need to use is the definition retention basin, rather than stormwater basin. A detention basin would be beneficial, whereas a retention basin, you want infiltration. You're going to hold the water till it infiltrates.
Yeah. Yes. And I suppose we could look at things such as naturalized basins. Again, you still have some disturbance of the terrain, I think, both with topography and with the disturbance of the vegetation, but that would probably be minimally disturbing of a use. So we can look into that.
Could they be engineered in a way? I used to work at a place in Doylestown that had the basin in front, but it was done more like a rain garden, but it was mammoth mm-hmm. area. So it was done in such a way that it would hold and gradually allow percolation out.
Right. I think we can take Mark, you have that down. I saw you writing.
I have that down. I also made one other notation just for the boards so that you're aware. I put in here that we need to take a look at this disturbance for the installation of utility lines. As many of you know, our sanitary sewer system runs in stream beds in many areas of Abington Township. And as the township engineer goes ahead and install stormwater management projects throughout Abington Township many times. That includes the increase or in the diameter of the pipes that feed these streams. So we may want to take a look at some language in there to allow that practice to continue or to add whatever safeguards you want to add for you know, their replanting of it when they're done. I don't want to lose the ability to use a gravity-fed sanitary sewer system.
Any other comments? Yes. Richard, you all set? Ms. Lehman?
So one comment I had back on page 34 is we had the use of pesticides, and it says that beyond the industry standards or the recommendations of the MC Conservation District. But one of the things I would like to see somewhere in this township is that we do not, we're actually going into our streams and spraying the heck out of the vegetation on each side of the streams in order to keep the streams from clogging up, okay, with vegetation. Well, that can be done by cutting that vegetation back and hiring somebody again to cut it when it needs to be cut again. The damage that we do with that kind of spraying to aquatic life and to all other forms of life that are in that stream
I think that's the point is well taken, but I think the point of all this is not to have to do that, is to adjust the districts through here that in such a way that the plantings and things would be beneficial.
To change the plantings, you're saying?
Yes, there's, over time, probably. But, I mean, the idea is to not allow all that kind of stuff to happen. And I think if there's a particular practice that is seen to occur, you can bring it to attention of that department and or Larry's office. But I think the point of this is to control in a very beneficial manner.
Well, that's what I'm wondering. That, right? I don't know what the wording is when it says the standards or recommendations of the MC Conservation District.
That's the Montgomery.
But I do know that between the two of them, both of them should emphasize that not just that pesticides be allowed to be used and herbicides and so on. Herbicides, by the way, are pesticides. Okay. So no. What we want to – yeah, they are.
One's plants and one's animals.
What's that?
One's plants and one's animals.
It's irrelevant. That's actually not true.
Okay, it's irrelevant. It's irrelevant. Well, at this, in the structure of this discussion, it's irrelevant.
Okay.
The point is also that these comments are compilations of commentary, not specific regulations.
Okay. So.
So it's a broad description of what.
What my comment is that I hope that we will find a place somewhere that will coordinate this and keep us from using pesticides in those irresponsible manners, because they are in the prescribed industry standards, that doesn't make them responsible. That's my point.
Okay. Appreciate that.
And insecticides are the things that kill insects. Pesticides cover rodenticides and fungicides.
I think the wording, if I can speak for the wording of that, is to address primarily what the speaker had just talked about, the Montgomery County Conservation District, which is what that MC right. Conservation District is. It's the Montgomery County Conservation District, stems from the regulations that have been passed along for those types of pesticides, fertilizers, and herbicides that have been prescribed by the EPA and the DEP, so along with the industry standards and the other checks and balances of the MC Conservation District.
Okay, thank you. Kathy?
I have a stream in the front of my house. My property is less than an acre, a little bit less. It has a historic, what's the word?
Bridge.
What do you call it? That collects water. So if I, you know, a spring house, has a spring house.
Okay.
So if I wanted to replace that, would people be permitted to do that or discouraged or not permitted to do that? It's definitely within 25 feet or so.
As an existing condition, I would, Mark, you'd probably have to address that.
No, I mean, if I look at this under riparian nonconformities, the footprint may not be expanded.
right?
But it does not have any language in there to prohibit you from repairing it, replacing it, making it structurally sound.
If somebody wanted to put a spring house in, they would not be permitted to.
Correct, but if you have an existing spring house, under nonconformities, the only prohibitive language is it cannot be expanded.
Okay.
And also, her property is less than an acre, so.
Well, that's okay. So it's only for an acre or more.
Yeah,
is that the way it works?
Only for the property is an acre.
So if you have a property that's less than an acre, how does that work with new construction in these? You know, if it's less than an acre, I didn't catch that. I saw in the beginning.
Well, the district doesn't even apply to you, so the evaluations would have no effect.
So if we have
Hold on a second. You still have DEP regulations where that still govern over the stream banks. It's not like just because you're less than an acre, a property owner can go in and do whatever they want to in a stream bank. They're still regulated through DEP regulations.
So if they wanted to put in a spring house, they would have to come before this body here?
They would actually
need
to.
They'd have to get a permit?
If they're less than an acre and they wanted to put a spring house in, they would actually have to engineer it and get approval from DEP.
Okay.
Which would be highly unlikely.
Oh, good. I'm glad to hear that. Are the floodplain requirements, do you feel, are strict enough? Or are they consistent with the stormwater management plan?
This is dealing with riparian buffers and riparian corridors. This is not floodplain. We'll be getting into the floodplain overlay in a second.
Okay.
Are there any other questions?
No, I think let's continue here. We're doing well.
Okay.
Steep slope?
I'm going to move on to the next overlay district, which is our steep slope conservation district. And we have two sections of the steep slope conservation district. This is an existing ordinance with some modifications. We have precautionary slopes, which are between 15 and 25. Slopes between 15 and 25 are now protected, as I think in the 1996 ordinance, they were outside of that regulation. At least 75% of the area developed, regrading and stripping of vegetation shall be prohibited. On at least 75% of the area. Then there are prohibitive slopes, which are slopes any that are greater than 25%. On at least 90% of the prohibitive slope area, development, regrading, or stripping of vegetation shall be prohibited unless the disturbance is for roadway crossings or utility construction, but in no case shall be more than 15% of the total prohibitive slope areas to be developed. So we're talking about we leave a 10% allowance for use in the steep slopes and protecting 90% of it, for the exception of those ideas of road crossings and utilities. We have permitted uses. A new use that has been added, or new uses, is the outdoor plant nursery or orchard is now a permitted use, and also emergency access roads. Conservation easements now required to preserve steep slopes. Trees over 6 inches and DBH is a diameter of breast height shall be preserved. And then there's a review of the township engineer. That would conclude the majority of the changes to our steep slope overlay ordinance. Are there any questions on that?
Just one comment. I'm very happy to see the conservation easement to be put in our ordinance after all this time. So thank you.
Sorry, to be what?
Happy that the conservation easement on the protected steep slopes is being provided in this ordinance, proposed ordinance.
Any other questions, comments?
Okay.
Let's go ahead.
Okay. We're going to move on to our floodplain ordinance, and you're going to move back to Article 16 in the ordinance. And our floodplain ordinance is revised to incorporate the Montgomery County Planning Commission model ordinance, the FEMA regulations, DEP regulations, and in fact, at the request of the township engineer and the code enforcement and zoning officer, we continued Abington's practice of being stricter within the floodplain ordinance than the actual model ordinances and regulations by the state. So the 100-year floodplain is now generally referred to as soils with a frequency of flooding of 1% or greater per year. as the new kind of designation as opposed to 100-year floodplain. Flood zones, names, and descriptions were updated to conform with the model ordinances. No longer permitted in floodplains, required yard areas, stormwater basins, parking facilities, bridges, culverts, dams, sewage treatment plants, and public water supply wells. Improvements to existing structures within the floodplain, no expansion or enlargement similar to what we talked about in the riparian for existing structures in the floodplain that would increase the BFE. I'm trying to remember what that
base flood elevation.
Base flood elevation. Couldn't remember the acronym. No expansion or enlargement of existing structures within the A&E area district with floodway that would, together with all other existing anticipated development, increase the BFE. And then you have some additional. We go into the residential uses. Lowest, so we have to have some specific regulations now within the floodplain, or updated the regulations. Lowest floor of new construction, including basement, now must be elevated 2 feet above base flood elevation instead of one foot. Manufactured homes must be elevated 1.5 feet above that BFE. Non-residential units, lowest floor of new construction must be flood-proofed up to the BFE height. And manufactured housing, as we said, special restrictions added, including not permitted within 50 feet from the top bank of the water course in the floodplain area.
Quick clarification, or should we?
I'm sorry?
I guess I can come back to that. It's a question about
Yeah, we're going to. This is.
Fine.
Go ahead. Let me go through it.
Go ahead.
Fully enclosed spaces below the lowest floor used exclusively for parking, access, or storage shall allow for automatic entry and exit of floodwaters. You can't trap the floodwaters is basically what we're talking about. Accessory uses, new restrictions must not be habitable, must be designed for automatic entry, once again allowing the water to flow through. And maximum size, there's maximum sizes, prohibition on permanent utility equipment, elevation of electrical of equipment also. RVs, special restrictions added, including may be on site for fewer than 180 consecutive days, meet same permit requirements as manufactured housing. And then the last is hazardous substances, special design and elevation requirements, such as like propane tanks and things along those lines, have special requirements now in the floodplains. And that would conclude the major changes, but I think the biggest takeaway is we now are conforming with the model ordinances and DEP regulations, and in fact, our ordinance is stricter than those model ordinances and requirements.
Can you explain how ours are stricter than the model ordinance?
I'll let Michael take care of it. Or Mark.
Can I make two corrections first? One in the overlay district where it talks about something that's no longer permitted. In the current ordinance, none of your required yards are within the floodplain. As you're aware, when you have a resource yard requirement like a floodplain, steep slope, wetlands, your required yard is measured from the outer edge of that restricted area, and that's where your yard requirement stays. One of the other corrections that need to be made in this is the prohibition on culverts. I don't know how our township engineer is going to do any kind of stormwater management work if he can't use culverts to get underneath roadways that are already within the floodplain or sit above the floodplain. So we're going to have to do that. A lot of the requirements that you see here listed, since we've maintained the fact that none of your required yards are allowed within the 100-year floodplain, it goes without saying that you can't construct in the 100-year floodplain. So although we're required to have recommendations for where first floor elevations are to be and where basement elevations are to be and what you can have or can't have as far as habitable space within a 100-year floodplain, this ordinance still prohibits you from building any type of structure within a 100-year floodplain. So we're pretty much when you say, why is it more restrictive? All I got to tell you is Florida, Louisiana, North Carolina, the Outer Banks, those areas continue to allow construction within a 100-year floodplain, and depending on which area you live in, every few years you're rebuilding your shack. We'd like to keep this to where we don't have to go through what we went through in 1996 with buying out of homes on streets, and then again in 2001 with the Bader Road issue and the amount of money that was put out by not only the state but also the township to purchase back those properties. Those homes were built prior to the floodplain regulations coming into effect in 1978, and we have very, very strong restrictive regulations that went in effect at 96. We'd like to keep them there. So,
question.
If I misspoke, gentlemen, correct me.
What, did I understand that the floodplain cannot intrude into yard setbacks?
It cannot now.
Cannot now.
Correct.
Okay. The logic of that is what? Because the building is not intruding, so what's the purpose of the restriction being?
It's the added protection. In other words, if you're required, if you're in an R4 district and you're only required to have a 10-foot required side yard setback, and you're allowed to use the floodplain as your setback, that required 10 feet, then literally your house could be built right at the edge of the floodplain line. Not quite the protection we were looking for back in 94, 95, 96 when the current ordinance was adopted. So we added in the setback requirement being from the outer edge of the easement. It just provided the township with an added measure of protection. And to be very honest with you, Larry's here to help me out with this. I can honestly tell you since 1996, we may have dealt with 5-6 applications dealing with encroachments into floodplain. And they were for open air structures that still allowed the water to flow,
underneath.
The largest one being Rydell Park with their parking deck
that had an
open area that didn't impede the flow of stormwater. So it hasn't been a problem for us to have this restrictive. We'd like to keep it that way. The township would like to be heavy-handed.
All right. Okay, thanks.
Can you clarify manufactured housing? There's no definition for that?
It's the definition that's provided in the building code.
Okay.
Yeah, the IRC.
Yes.
All right.
And we have the new firm maps, they haven't been formally yet approved or?
Right.
Oh, still
no,
not.
Ma'am.
Okay. I didn't think so because I saw the blanks for the. Okay.
Yes, we know.
If you're an existing structure, you can't do an increase that creates a higher base flood elevation.
Correct.
If you do compensating groundwork so that the flood elevation is not changed, you can enlarge or change an existing building.
I would tell you no, because you're not permitted any grade change within the limits of the 100-year floodplain. So you would be hard-pressed to figure out how to mediate an increase of stormwater if you can't change the existing grades.
Okay.
Actually, it's very interesting. If you look at the open channel flow, if you take an obstruction out of a stream, if you actually remove an obstruction, you will increase the flood level. For example, the Schuylkill River, they wanted to remove some of the tension base where they were holding the coal. Actually, if you remove them, Conservation Energy determines that removal of those obstructions will result in a local increase in water level.
This young man is a civil engineer. Is that everyone?
So I've gone round and round
specializes
with FEMA
in hydraulical engineering.
But to that point, Solbury Township's taking down a dam, and yes, it will increase the floodplain, but they did all the studies to make sure it wouldn't impact so they could have a natural running trout fishing stream. So, you know, there's pros and cons both But if you're, I think, you know, it's common sense, don't build in the floodplain.
Well, and a lot of the requirements that you see in here are in here for two reasons. One, because FEMA now requires you to have regulations for construction in a floodplain. It's addressed within the building code. It's a requirement for FEMA, and it was written into the model ordinances that the county put together. The other issue as to why they're in there is because, as you are all well aware, 90% plus of this township was built out prior to the adoption of floodplain regulations mm-hmm. that they came in effect here in Abington in 1978. So we have these properties that are out there. We need to have maintenance requirements for them. We certainly don't want to put additional people at risk. So the prohibition about finishing off basements of these homes or letting them add in walkout basements or egress windows in a floodplain is a pretty good idea to prohibit that. I don't want to use your basement as a temporary detention basin.
Okay. Don, gentlemen.
Thank you. I think we're all set. It's, I'm sorry, there's any other comments? Okay, right. Let's go ahead.
Let's go. Land
preservation. So we're going to move on to our last overlay district, which is our land preservation overlay district. And this is an existing overlay district, has been used not many times, I think once, over at, what's the name, Walnut Lane or Walnut?
Twice. You have
Rydell
the
Green.
Rydell Green development and also what eventually became the Myers Payone development right. there off of Meeting House Road. Yeah.
No, off of Huntington Pike.
Huntington Pike.
And Meeting House, right where they come
the
in.
Oh,
right.
Yeah.
Right, you're right, I'm sorry.
Steven's still trying to find that.
it's word three. He doesn't get over there.
Not my word. Anyhow, so the land preservation ordinance, as it's written currently, is required for any tract of land that's 15-plus acres, and it's optional for tracts of land that are 5 to 15 acres. We changed that. The required tract is now 10-plus acres, so we reduced it. So if you have reduced the requirement, which actually captures more larger properties, and an optional for tracts that are 5 to 10 acres. It is still a conditional use. The density is now based on net site area, and that net site area takes out the spaces and the information that's in the ordinance, such as floodplains, and undevelopable spaces is what the net site area would be made up of. Developments of at least 30 units can be comprised of two separate dwelling types, and you'll see that the dwelling types in the allowable in the land preservation ordinance consist of single family homes and village style homes. Minimum required preservation area is reduced from 75% to 50%. The primary reason for doing that, it looks in a negative fashion, but the reason for doing that is to try to entice property owners that are in that 5-acre to 10-acre space to incentivize the leftover 50% with greater density or a greater allowance to bring in property, to bring in housing, but also preserve 50% of that property. So it was kind of a push and pull in that situation.
Well, Steve, too, since it's now on net density, so it's probably not
right.
that big of a reduction.
That's right. You're also now looking at a smaller space to begin with. That's right. So you'll see here, I'm not going to go through every specific thing, but the dimensional requirements are slightly different than in your normal residential districts because, as Kathy just pointed out, we are compacting space. We're trying to give a bonus to people that are going to preserve 50% of their net track area. So we reduce some of the setbacks, the impervious coverages and all those things along there so that the density actually works out and we get the land preserved. There are incentives for shorter yards if people were to design homes that de-emphasize garages, which means the garage has side entries and are not primary to the front elevation or have front porches. And we architectural plans and elevations so that if they want to get those incentives, would need to be submitted and presented in front of the Planning Commission. And that takes care of the changes to the Land Preservation Ordinance. I should also mention that most of the properties, I think it is, has an R1, mm-hmm. an R1 requirement. So this would only apply to properties zoned R1, which are mainly yeah. on the eastern part of the township in the Rydal Meadowbrook area. And I think we identified there was probably, right now there's probably close to about 20, 25 properties that would meet the 5 to 10 acre, and very few properties that would meet the 10 plus acre unless somebody was to actually assemble property. Are there any questions on the LPD ordinance?
Steve, if you want to not have garages in the front, I can understand that from an aesthetic point of view, but then if you do bring garages in other ways, doesn't that spread you out and actually work counter to the purpose of creating density?
We did look at some test fits and how that would lay out on a property, you know, based on the turnaround or the backup radius or the backup dimension you would need for that parking area before you get into the garage, and what a potential width of the house would be in order to make that work. We believe that dimensional requirements allow for that to occur.
Okay.
I think the idea also is in a property that's going to be developed as a land preservation in the land preservation district, we kind of envision would be primarily an older population, and the houses could be oriented in different ways than you would see in a traditional single family home. But once again, it's not a requirement, it's an incentive.
Any other comments or questions from us? Is that
okay?
So this ordinance is one of my pet peeves. I have seen again and again and again how this ordinance encourages people to stack the building up and supposedly have lots of green space that's shared open space. Then as soon as nobody's looking, the developer goes in for a variance or sells it under some distressed conditions, and the green space is built upon. You have only to look at Rydal Park that was originally zoned for 45 units. They got special exceptions to build intensely in the smaller front portion, which I think might have been 11 acres. And they left the 35 acres or so in the back as green space, open space, community space, lovely space. As soon as nobody was looking, that got divided off. There's now 100 units on the part in the back called Rydal Waters.
It's 84 units. There, 96 units.
97. So I'm rounding out. But you know, what we have is we went from 45 units to saying, well, we'd like to do this, give us a little extra in this corner, and then we're going to have all this green space for the community. And immediately, nobody was looking, and it got divided off. And that has been a scenario again and again and again with this kind of zoning. And I see some of you shaking your heads. You clearly have not watched it or followed it if you don't believe that that's what's happening. So I am directly opposed to this. We do much better when we have development, and the green space is owned by many different people who treasure it and won't give it up for money to have double the people on it. Thank you.
Thank you.
So to react or to give some clarity, the two properties that were developed under the Land Preservation Ordinance have not been, their open space areas have not been amended or changed or have any requested changes. The property in which the speaker was speaking about, which is the Rydal Waters property, was assembled. There was a zoning change that was incorporated in for that for the original 84 homes. And then it was also changed to the SNR district, the Senior Neighborhood Residential District, that brought it to 90 to 96 homes. And it's fair to say that or it's actually accurate to say that under a portion of that property, and back in, I guess it was the 1990s, Mark, they, Rydell Park had a preliminary plan approval for, I think it was close to 200 apartments.
Oh, no, it was over 300 units.
300 apartment units.
Buildings.
So, it was a by right use at the time. Well, actually, it was still a by right use because a portion of that property was zoned AO. Is that, yeah?
It was. So. It still is.
Well, no, not even. So, if you actually look at the history of that property, the intensity of that property is much less than what could have been constructed.
Could have been developed.
Correct. So, and we're going to move on. If there's no more questions, I'm going to move on to the sign ordinance.
Well, with this, the NC district, the open space is required to be deed restricted. If the land preservation district, like they did in Walnut Hill, I mean, Larry and I walked that whole property and identified trees, et cetera. But no, I think there's more protection under this because you actually have.
That's right. And it's also a conditional use.
So
it's,
they can't further subdivide
that's right.
it like a private homeowner could.
That's right. And you are, it is a conditional use. It has an extra level of protection as it sits. I think it's also counterproductive to the actual name of the ordinance, as with land preservation, to allow for changes to that 50% mark, just based on the idea of what the ordinance is written for.
Okay. Are there any qualifications or conditions associated with that 50% open space? That it be accessible, that it be publicly accessible, that it be visible?
It's not required to be publicly accessible. It's required to be accessible by the actual development, and it needs to be maintained.
And there are amenities, actually, that are permitted in it.
Yeah, walking trails.
Right, okay.
I think there's pavilions or something, you know, open gathering space, but, you know, those areas are all to be maintained by
the homeowners association.
By the owners association, homeowners association that's developed for the land preservation district.
Okay, thanks.
Okay.
All right.
There's no more questions. I'm going to move on to number five of our agenda, which is our sign ordinance.
Number five or number four?
Five. Yeah. So I'm going to go through this, Mark. I'm going to need you to jump in here since you concentrated on a lot of this. Okay. The sign ordinance, once again, is another one of those ordinances that the Zoning Ordinance Committee had a subcommittee work on specifically. Mark was integral in that. And so we're going to go through that. There's comprehensive dimensional and lighting requirements established. So if maximum heights or lighting type was not specified, we now have some specifications for that within the ordinance. Home occupation signs illumination is now permitted if it's external, which means like a landscape light on the ground. And wall signs are now permitted. And I think there are dimensional requirements that restrict the size of those home occupation signs. Prohibited signs.
I'm sorry, so wall signs are prohibited or permitted?
Prohibited. It's correct up there.
Or prohibited. Yeah, I'm prohibited, not, I'm sorry.
He said permitted. That's why I was.
My apologies.
Okay, I'm reading prohibited.
I realize that. I'm just making sure that what shows up in a minute is.
prohibited signs, off-premise sign, except directional signs. And you can see the crossed-out language that we've eliminated from the sign ordinance. Neon signs are no longer prohibited, which means you can have them. Identification signs in residential districts may now be illuminated, and once again, they need to be illuminated externally. Vehicular sign not permitted in public right-of-way longer than 24 hours in any 30-day period of time. That really deals with signage on cars and trucks that are. Now
you've seen them, the rolling billboards.
Yeah, the rolling billboard signage.
Now it gets parked in some businesses' front parking lot, and it stays there. Mm. That's what this is in there to address
things. Okay.
Suggested changes since the draft: no signs may be erected within or across a public right of way, except for temporary signs, which are approved by the Township of Abington, and for the general permit of the. Benefit of the township, and that is a separate ordinance that the Board of Commissioners passed, which allows for those banner signs that you see across Old York Road advertising you know, the Abington Night Out and things along those lines. And we get into some of the specific district changes. Apartment office district, freestanding signs, maximum area reduced from 50 square feet to 40 square feet, maximum height reduced from 20 to 12 feet. And monument signs, maximum area reduced from 100 square feet to 50 square feet, and maximum height from 10 feet to 8 feet. So you can see we did some reducing of the regulations in the apartment office area. Community service district, monument signs, the maximum area reduced from 75 feet to 50 square feet, and maximum height from 10 to 7 feet. To coincide with the changes in our Main Street district, we did some comparisons and meshing of our regulations within the small commercial districts in the 1996 ordinance, and you see some of the changes up here, some reductions and some changes to height restrictions and things that coordinate with the street walls, street wall ideas, and some of the other architectural incentives that we have within the Main Street district. In our BC district, we designate differences between joint use property identification, so signage that is used for identifying multiple tenants or multiple establishments within that property, within the properties that are located in the BC district. And then we have joint use properties signs for individual uses with external access. So some of those pad sites that you might see on some of these larger commercial districts that would have their own access points and regulations on what they can have in addition to that joint use property identification signage. Now we also have joint use property signs for individual uses with external access, similar going along, you know, this is a continuation of those requirements. We deal more specifically with changeable messages. Digital and LED signs are now regulated in more specificity than there is in the existing 1996 ordinance. This has been a source of, I don't know, Bruce, numerous zoning board applications and we continue to get applications for these type of signs. So with Mark's history and an input by Ed Meebus, who sat on our zoning hearing board, we were able to come up with regulations which we felt regulate those things without dealing with some of those zoning hearings. So these are some of those regulations, or most of the regulations you'll see. The next is signs exempt from permits, which deal with primarily our temporary signage. Probably the biggest source subject, and this is a constitutional change in the zoning ordinance, and this was directed by actually both of our solicitors, former solicitor and our current solicitor, that political signs, whereas we were able to reduce the square footage size of the political signs, we had to eliminate the requirement or the regulations on erecting of these signs 30 days prior to election and to be removed within 10 days following election. The new requirement must be removed within 7 days. That is actually going to be stricken from the ordinance. We are not allowed to regulate the time frame that these temporary signs can actually sit on one's property. So the only regulation change that will happen is everything will be stricken from the political signs for the exception of the size. And the other big change that's going to happen, we also prohibited political signs from our public right-of-ways. We can't do that either. So, it's gonna be hard. Yes.
The only limitations on them is they cannot cause a site obstruction.
And unfortunately, these are not recommendations that the Zoning Ordinance Committee are embracing. These have been conversations with our former solicitor and our current solicitor, and these are proven constitutional challenges that have caused these changes to need to be made in our ordinance. So,
So that's just political signs that are allowed in
Well, it basically evens them out. Political signs were used to be treated differently than most temporary signs in the township. We had more restrictions on political signs as opposed to just normal temporary signs, like, you know, advertising an electrician who just did work on your house. There was really no restrictions on the time frame that they could be up. The plain fact of the matter is we needed to even those all out, and the reality is political signs can't be restricted by time frame.
Right, but in the right-of-way, are other signs permitted in the right-of-way, the street right-of-way, besides now political signs?
No, there are also still public information signs that are permitted there that we covered a little three slides ago.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
That's right. Public signs, maximum area increased from 8 to 16 square feet, once again evening that out, and real estate signs now have a limit, have a height limit of 4 feet. Signs requiring permits now have a 4-foot height limit unless otherwise specified. We have active signs, and we have bunting and pennant signs. You've seen those. The pennant signs are the ones that, well, you got it. I don't need to describe it. Then we go into the bonus structures, which we actually dealt with within the Main Street District and the BC District, so I'm not going to go into those too specifically, but there are bonuses for how signs are incorporated and what they look like for the Main Street District and the Business Center District.
Can you explain why this change came about?
Which change?
When you just did the bonus.
Yeah.
Or what the logic of the bonus is? Kind of.
Yes. I mean, one of the first things we did was make sure that after the bonus was granted, the sign size is reasonable, in our opinion. So we did that, and then we looked at things which we didn't necessarily feel should be required for aesthetic purposes, design purposes, but we think are best practices currently being used by businesses relatively commonly now, and so we gave people the option. So it's not being required, but we're trying to incentivize what we consider some of those better practices, halo lighting, and that's backlit lighting. It just has less glare, but has what is generally considered an attractive sign design. Gooseneck lighting, you know, adds an attractive element, kind of a historic.
Kind of like the restaurant thing, looping over their sign thing.
Yes, okay. Yes. So it adds a design element. And the logo is intended to help signs be more rapidly recognized. So with the idea that when you look around and say, you see the red bullseye from a Target sign, you know, it takes you a quarter of a second to recognize it compared to reading the word or what have you. And it also just adds just a little bit more of an attractive area. Okay.
Thank you, Mike.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Any comments? Are we there?
I got just a couple. I mean, there's non-conforming signs, how we deal with that. And if you remove two signs and you replace it with a single sign, there are some incentives to doing that. There's special sign regulations as far as vulgar language and pornographic material. Sign construction, we go into some standards as to the sign construction that deals with signs that may be close to pedestrian walkways, and just to get some more restrictions or recommendations on how signs should be constructed so that there is some conformity in the township on signage within our business districts. And that primarily, there's one other thing that I should mention. We had left out changes to our off-site advertising signage, sign ordinance. Currently, the off-site advertising would be billboards. The township currently has a prohibition on billboards. At the advice of council, we are starting to look at changing that ordinance. It had been told to us before was to leave the ordinance the way it was as we went through some of the litigation matters that were going on with billboards. But at this point, we feel we've been advised that we should start taking a look at changing that, and our solicitor is starting to work on that. So
okay.
So that concludes the sign ordinance changes.
With the neon signs, I can't find them in the ordinance, but I know you said that they're now permitted. Do we say that they can't be blinking or anything like that?
Blinking flashing.
No. The current ordinance that we had only allowed neon, providing it was encased neon.
Okay.
And the issue there is dating back to the neon that we were all familiar with when we were much younger, which was a glass tube energized with a gas, and that gas was energized and created motion and color. In years ago, the fire departments experienced two very tragic events during the winter months where they went out and hit neon tubing with cold water during a fire event, and it exploded in the fireman's face. So there was language put in the 96 ordinance that allowed for neon, providing it was in a clear encasement. And you see it down at Abington Library, you see it at Hibachi Grill, that type of thing. That's now become the industry standard, where you no longer have exposed glass tubing, so that's why we've altered the language to go back to it. They don't make the glass tubing anymore. It's now a plastic tube. So now that the safety issue's been resolved, we're back to...
It's just in Hatboro, so they have some of the flashing old neon.
And it dates back to the 50s.
Yeah, it's...
And we prohibit...
We bypass that. It's called Byberry Road, or Blair Mill Road.
Yeah. And we prohibit flashing signs, too, so...
So can you clarify the political... stuff we were talking about before? So that basically means anybody can put up anything in, within the sign, the size limitations, and leave it there?
Well, they can leave them there. That's correct. We used to have restrictions on how many signs you can have on your property. We used to have restrictions on the fact that they couldn't be in public right-of-ways. We used to have...
Couldn't be on commercial properties.
It couldn't be used on commercial properties. Unfortunately, those restrictions all need to be stripped out.
Okay, and that's on page 211G. Like, that's in our proposed ordinance. I should just cross that out.
Yeah, there are a couple changes from what's in the proposed ordinance that we already know that we're going to have to make.
Okay.
Correct.
Okay.
That's right. There were a couple of restrictions that we thought we could leave in there based on some of the conversations, and I think they were a misinterpretation on our part from the solicitors. And now we've had some clarity, and... Unfortunately, clarity did not go in our favor. When I say ours, I mean the township's favor.
Right. Okay, what about the litter signs that, you know, I find in creeks and woodlands all over the place that are like, they're temporary, they look like, they're like, you know, sell your house, call mm-hmm. this number.
No, they're
are
still those... illegal signs.
Yeah, but okay. That's still. Yeah.
Okay.
We have parameters for temporary public information signs. You see them up all over our mm-hmm. township.
Than the ones that put on the utility poles.
Correct. I mean, the ones we're talking about advertise, you know, Boy Scout registration, mm-hmm. Baseball,
soccer,
softball,
yeah.
football, whatever the sport may
Some
be,
event,
whatever the activity would be. I mean, you see it advertised for adult activities. So-and-so's promoting a blood drive. That's a mm-hmm. temporary public information sign. The signs that we are trying to get to are the signs that we've been policing up for the last 20-plus years, which are the, you see it, the low-cost dental insurance, we buy houses, you know, A1 driveway ceiling,
They put them up over the weekends, and you can see they're doing it over
a
truck, and then, you know, they're like 20 feet high.
Right, so those are still...
They're still prohibited signs.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah, they're for-profit signs. They're not public information signs.
Okay.
Are there comments from us?
So do we know where we are with the lawsuit that was filed with the billboards? We haven't had an update on that in a long time.
The last information that we got was the decision from the higher courts has been that it's been remanded back to the Zoning Hearing Board for those... for those zoning, were they variance requests?
They were variances.
Zoning variance requests to be heard by the Zoning Hearing Board. At this point, those hearings have not been scheduled, nor have they been requested to be scheduled by the applicant.
That is correct.
Okay. And I'm hoping we could get like a webpage with some information on that posted, you know, so that people can follow where we are with that, because they're concerned about that. It affects all over the township. The thing with the public right-of-ways, I don't fully understand that. Does that mean that I could run out and put a political sign out in a in a public right-of-way?
Correct.
I'm not sure. Or does that mean that I can apply for a permit to put one in public? In other words, can somebody just go out and stick something in the public right-of-way?
Correct.
Within the size parameters.
Other than the size parameter, yes, you're correct. You could go out and...
And just stick one in the ground.
You could put one of my commissioner signs out on the public right-of-way.
Can I put your opponents out there?
Sure.
We eliminated them.
Yeah, unfortunately, that's your...
Okay. So do we need a permit to do that in the public right-of-way?
No.
You're just saying anybody can put a political sign, but
yes.
Not
public land. It's public land. It's free speech. That's kind of the phrases that were explained to us.
Okay. And one of the things that I'll just mention about the legal advice on that, I know when we did the solicitation and we were told that we had to have solicitors in our neighborhood, there was some case law that allowed solicitors in the neighborhood. It actually was weaker than the case law that allowed you to prohibit solicitors in the neighborhood. And so in this particular case, I would like to see if we would follow that up, because I remember, it had to be 25 years ago or so, we had a political race that was so heated, every inch of this township was covered with signs. And once we allow public right-of-ways to do that, every election period, it's going to be an absolute disaster. And people were really upset about
it. So we are unfortunately comfortable in the fact that the opinions that have been given to us have been verified, not just from our solicitors, but from individual conversations that we've had with other land use and municipal attorneys.
Okay, and then I'll add one thought on to that, and that is that a lot of the decisions that come down against what the general public would like is because all of the people that profit from that, gain from that, are part of that. They're paid to go to those meetings, but the people that are representing us are not at those meetings fighting hard. So we would ask maybe that you unite with people from other townships and fight that kind of
These are constitutional issues. They're not.
Yeah, these are not
convenience.
Case law is created by whoever has the biggest guns in the court at the time.
And but it's not going to make it into the zoning ordinance at this point.
Yeah, it's not about the Constitution. Is not something that one person knows what it is and everybody else has to listen.
I think we're digressing from what we can include in the zoning ordinance at this point, given the legal advice.
Yeah.
There's not a heck of a lot that could be done there.
So I'm just asking for you to find a way to support us in fighting that and getting some case law going the other way.
Are there any considerations about lumens to decrease light pollution or incentives we could give for energy efficiency in terms of illuminating lighting? Are there different requirements for commercial areas versus residential areas for lumens?
And also in terms of dark sky regulations,
There are still lighting requirements within the ordinance that discuss the restriction on bleeding light onto properties and the glare factor of lighting. Those restrictions and regulations are still existing in the ordinance. As far as bonuses for energy efficient lighting, Michael or
One of the sections we have is simply in the general regulations, 2601G lighting standards. So that addresses a variety of lighting issues to limit light trespass and glare and things of that nature. Energy efficiency, I don't believe we do. No.
Maybe we can take a look at that? Okay. Is there differences? You differentiate between how much I can illuminate the front of my house versus how much a commercial district, or is there timing issues perhaps?
So, like, so you're not talking about relative electrical efficiency of a light fixture. You're talking about how
part of it, but I'm also talking about light. One is light pollution and the other is energy.
Can we point out? We're also skipping up over a few things here. We're talking about site lighting as opposed to signage.
I'm talking about illumination.
Right. So the site lighting issues are primarily dealt with in the land, in the SALDO and the subdivision and land development ordinance, and not in this actual zoning ordinance. The only time it's regulated in zoning ordinance is when it deals with an issue regarding zoning as far as signage in this case. So
maybe that's something our EAC could look at
that. Okay. It's something that the EAC certainly could look at. It would be something that the EAC would get involved in when the revisions of the SALDO
But in terms of the zoning right now, is that something maybe we could, I don't know if Philadelphia used it as a incentive, but
you're talking about for signage lighting. I'm
talking about illuminated signs. Like, you know, could we, is there a way?
I'm not so sure that's something that would sit in the zoning ordinance. I believe that's something that would be relegated to the land development ordinance.
What, can I ask why? It seems like a particular, if you could put a sign or something.
No, I think you're talking about. You're talking about overall site lighting, not just sign lighting.
I think it's a wide variety.
We have limitations related to sign lighting.
These are illuminated. You've described illuminated signs, so I'm wondering, you know, one is from an environmental light pollution perspective, and then the other is from an energy efficient perspective.
We do have regulations as far as lighting is concerned, and those things that CAC is talking about related to signs themselves, not related to site lighting. Site lighting is dealt with in the land development ordinance.
We also have language that's in there that limits under your environmental restrictions in the ordinance. We also have limitations on spillover lighting. We have requirements as to what the foot candle readings have to be at a minimum at any point throughout a parking lot. But then we also have language that prohibits. You can't have any more than 1 foot candle overflow measured at 10 feet from a property line, if I remember correctly.
Yeah, right. And it depends on the district we're talking about.
That's what
we're talking about residential districts
and lighting flowing into residential districts, there's stricter requirements because we want less light to get into the residential areas. Whereas if you have a commercial area, it's not so much of an issue, so it's a higher threshold.
Are there recommended lumens? I mean,
It's currently based on foot candles. I think increasingly you'll see the shift to lumens.
Okay.
We also have specific limits for lighting intensity of changeable message signs, and that's handled a little bit differently. And then we also have standard signage lighting limits.
Okay, thanks.
Sure.
Thank you. Any other questions?
Okay. Any other questions on signage? We are at just about 9:15. We have one section left to go, which is parking and transportation. I'll take the Planning Commission's advice on this, whether you want to continue.
Happening, I think let's do it and try to get through it by 9.
I think we can get through this pretty quickly, if not a few minutes after 9.
I'd like to give it a shot and get it over.
Like I said, it's entirely up to you.
Okay,
so I'm going to move on to parking and transportation standards. We have, and we've discussed this in our bonuses and in our commercial districts, we now have shared access, a process that facilitates shared access and, by extension, shared parking. Required access easements to be granted as non-residential, mixed-use, and multifamily use developed. Facility shared parking and access is wide area, is in a wide area over time. Requires number of curb cuts in the area to be reduced. Once again, the shared parking, primarily as you see it in our the northern section of Old York Road and parts of Eastern Road, is to eliminate that the clutter of curb cuts and de-emphasizing the pedestrian traffic. And that's the reason we've put in the shared parking incentives. Then we have I think Mark was in it. Integral in this also was to change some of the parking requirements as they relate to the Institute of Transportation Engineers parking standards. So I'm going to go through these. Some of our newer, I'm out of page. So our accessory dwelling units, which is a new use, we have one additional space is required for each registered driver that's in the access, and that has to be off-site. I mean, it has to be, on-site. It has to be an on-site parking space. Car share, one parking space per vehicle associated with the car share, in addition to a vehicle required elsewhere on the site. Farmers market, no impact. Home-based businesses are no additional spaces required over and above what is required for the residence itself. RV storage and on residential properties, storage of RVs shall not diminish the required on-site parking. So if you have, if you're required to have a parking space, two of them, and you put a RV on your driveway and it blocks and you don't have a garage, now you've eliminated all your parking. So that's not allowed. Currently that restriction doesn't exist. We have our agricultural land use parking requirements. Bed and breakfast is another land use or use regulation that has been added to this ordinance. Flip through some of these. We have our, we have group home and personal care home regulations now, which is part of the required use from state regulations. We've updated the nursing home parking requirements, art gallery, the studios, both artists, dance, fitness, and martial arts. We have a parking requirement for those, which didn't exist in the original, in the 1996 ordinance. And then we have parking, new parking calculations for mixed-use building based on gross leasable floor area and mixed-use developments in the BC Noble area, which is where the Noble train station is. Two spaces per dwelling unit, non-residential uses, are calculated based upon the specific use. For sites that are less than an, that are greater than an acre, at least a half a percent of the spaces provided shall be dedicated to car share facility spaces. That's to emphasize that car share car share idea. We have requirements for bus pickup locations for multiple use retail centers and BC business center districts complexes greater than 100,000 square feet. They need to provide a pickup area for public transportation and must accommodate a 40-foot bus, so a 40-foot bus could park in that location. We have requirements for electric and hybrid vehicles, parking lots, garages with 100-plus spaces, at least 3 out of 100 must be reserved for electric or hybrid cars, basically charging stations. Loading reduction in space size is now permitted where it can be demonstrated that loading only will be performed by small trucks or vans upon agreement with the township. Requirements table updated for the for example, and you can go through those. We have parking lot and frontage development standards. These relate to the commercial districts and our street walls and those architectural ideas, interconnections on properties, and how they affect parking lots and parking areas. We have regulations in here to encourage walkability on a multi-use site, specifically in shopping centers and transit-oriented developments, main access with main access drives and secondary access drives. And then we have our special access requirements specifically for the Main Street district. Width of walkways, width of planting strips. And then I'm going to let Michael go through this.
Okay.
These are Michael's diagrams. These are more information on the special access requirements for the Main Street district.
Sure, and this just spells out and illustrates the concept for how you go through the required shared access process. And so when a property develops, you need only grant an access easement to adjacent properties so that in the future, if an adjacent property were to develop and you'd already granted that access easement, then that adjacent property, then going through land development, would have to grant another access easement to your property so that shared access would then effectively exist. So it doesn't go into an existing property owner and say you need to share access immediately. It only comes into play when land developments occur, and it occurs gradually over time. And one of the benefits of this I see is that it does require what you might consider an excessive number of curb cuts to disappear over time, so that access is more efficient, predictable, it's more pedestrian friendly. Pedestrian doesn't have to cross 27 curb cuts as they walk down half a block. So again, it's very gradual and essentially comes down to granting access one property at a time, one land development at a time. And it doesn't apply to residential, you know, single family residential areas. It applies to non-residential, mixed use areas, and multifamily uses. Okay. And the diagram just kind of lays that out. You can look yourself and see, you know, how that might play out. I'm not going to point at all the arrows and so forth, but
you can see that in the diagrams that Mike was provided, the domino effect that it would occur as access easements are granted.
Yeah, actually, that is a good point. You can see that on the slides there. And so, for example, the X's indicate closed access points that had formerly existed, and you can see they're originally on this block, say in a strip commercial development, you'd have a million different access points. The blue arrows indicate the access easements being granted, so you can go cross lot rather than be forced to go onto the street to go back into another parking area every time you go from one store to another and you move your car. The pink squares are indicating new access points. So over time, you might shrink down from, with those four properties, you might shrink from about eight access points to about three.
How do you see this happening? I mean, is this by request of the related property owners, or is it?
Or
do you see it when there's a consolidation of properties? Or?
Well, all this is requiring is the access easements being granted.
Who would ask? How do you see it being engendered? I mean,
In the zoning through land development, as you develop your property, you're required to establish that access easement.
It's also beneficial to any developer to consider this. I mean, you now have a shared parking complex, which reduces the total number of parking spaces that they would require to have if they were all individual uses. Mm-hmm. In addition to that, the benefit side of it is it allows more room by reducing the amount of required impervious coverage, and hopefully providing us with additional green space
and
buffer areas.
The benefits, I'm thinking, though, in many Main Street districts, you have a variety of single owners, small lots, et cetera, as opposed to a development.
Well, and that's just the point. So that's just the point of requiring the access easements, is so if you do have those series of small properties, through time, those access easements would actually create more of a system where you would have a combined development of a shopping center.
When does that happen? If somebody decides to renovate, then it triggers that? Or
land development. They would have to go through land
development. There are existing conditions in a main street.
Isn't this one of our incentives as well? Like you get a point in the...
Well, it is, because you get to enact these shared parking requirements if you're able to accumulate three or more.
That's another incentive.
Three or more of these properties. I mean, we are seeing it slowly come into fruition. Larry and I are dealing with a development or a potential development down on Old York Road that was the accumulation of three existing properties, and the current owner has talked to us about, even though the property directly to the north of him is owned by somebody else, including them in with the parking requirements. We've seen this down in Ward 6 along Limekiln Pike, where a gentleman over the course of the last 3 years has now been able to acquire four consecutive properties and has done a nice job renovating it. Unfortunately, there is no parking for those properties, so it isn't there. But we are seeing this, somebody goes into a neighborhood, they buy a specific property, and, you know, here's two instances that are on our table at the same time where they've been able to acquire three or four properties in a row over a 2 or 3 year period. So it's happening.
Could you go back a slide to the first one?
Mm-hmm.
My question is, what incentive is there to property owner number 2 and number 4
right.
to provide access to property number 3? I mean, is there any incentive for those two adjacent property owners to do that?
In the first case, we're dealing with, let's see, and I'm looking at, okay, so if we're looking here at property 3 developing,
right,
so the only thing that occurs at the beginning is that property 3 grants access to property 2 and 4.
Right.
So 2 and 4 is able to use property 3 for access to the street, right?
Okay.
Then,
but
in this,
you've already got access to the street, so.
Okay, but you would ask, what's the incentive? What's the bonus? Right. What is the what's the payoff for 2 and 4?
Correct.
In reality,
why would they?
Let's take a look
nice
at
guys.
Let's take a look at whatever the uses is, and make up whatever use you are. One's retail, takeout, food. The other one's office. In property number 2, if it's retail, takeout, food, sir, they're limited in the number of seats they can have based on the number of parking spaces they have. It's one parking space for every 3 seats. They're limited to their indoor service area, if it's a takeout establishment, to one parking space for every 75 square foot of patron area. So if you now have a shared parking complex, you have additional parking spaces available to you. Many times a use and occupancy certificate is given to us to review, and the occupancy certificate is limited because of the available on-site parking. They may want 24 seats in their restaurant, but they only have parking available for 12 or 16. So the use and occupancy is then limited. If you had a shared parking complex and they now have the availability to pick up access to an additional 5 or 6 spaces, that occupancy certificate could be amended to now allow for the available mm-hmm. extra parking.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, there's where I see the potential bonus. I may not monetarily gain anything, but for a practical use, mm-hmm. I'm gaining something.
So you're seeing it as a self-evident enhancement to the mm-hmm. owners as opposed to any...
I mean, one of our biggest problems in our existing commercial districts are the size of the individual properties.
Oh, yeah.
And one of the most limiting factors is available on-site parking.
Right. Yes. Mm-hmm.
This is right. our attempt to try to create a new idea.
So by allowing That's it, good. Clever people will see, hey, there's some advantage to
well,
it.
Well, there's a bonus to it.
You also have to close off driveways, right. too, over time. So, for example, in this last example, property number 4 has to use access from property 3.
Right.
So they need to close off their access point and use the access on property 3. So over time, you're acquiring the reduction in access points.
Okay.
And just by virtue of over time developing all that shared access, it's going to be much easier to share parking. And so it'll be much easier for a user of your business to park at an adjacent business and, okay. and simply walk over.
Yeah, and plus it's going to make the main street more walkable. I mean,
oh,
it's
no,
going to improve all that.
Yeah, the big picture is the bottom line.
How you,
exactly. Yeah.
How are you entice somebody to bother doing this?
Especially the older areas that we have.
Well, I mean, it's not an enticement. It's a requirement.
One question that goes back to an earlier subject. There was a nice lady in one of our earlier meetings who's probably a neighbor of Larry's who was asking about overparking on residential properties. Is there any restriction in our new ordinance that would begin to address that?
No, you had asked us to add that as one of the, at this point, what's turned out to be 4, almost 5 pages worth of text of
ideas that you want us to go back and address. That's
okay.
One of them.
That's yeah. Still on the list.
There's been no modifications okay. To the draft ordinance that you haven't
promised to do that and look into
meeting
it.
One to now.
And there's this, and on that topic, it's a, you know, it's a discussion that has to take place among the Zoning Ordinance Committee. It's also something that will be brought up by the board and to see whether what their feelings are on that subject.
Okay. Okay.
They're still, just like everything else that was vetted through the Zoning Ordinance changes, that'll be one of those things that will be vetted. Okay. It's not something that's been decided at this point.
One question occurs to me on these diagrams. The way these diagrams are drawn, it makes you think they're conflicting with any attempt to create build-to lines and move buildings further forward. What do you think?
I understand what you're saying. I mean, we're just asking you to set that aside for now.
Okay.
However, in the Main Street districts, you're allowed to have, and it works the same way. But furthermore, in the Main Street districts, you're allowed to have the building set back, of course, as long as you have a street wall.
Okay. I realize we're at our time. I want to raise one other question going back to the ADU, the accessory dwelling unit, requiring
yes.
additional space required for each registered driver. It seems to me potentially excessive if the point of these ADUs is, say, aging parents or something like that, where you may not have a car per person or what have you. Is that directly necessary?
Yeah, I noticed the same thing. It's something that we maybe need to re-clarify is whether it needs to just be one space period as opposed to one space per registered driver. I agree.
Okay. Thank you. Any other questions from us? Any other questions? Then at this point, once we are finished with commentary, we will be concluding the meeting per our decision regarding it because of the snow. Thanks.
Is it snowing?
Are there any requirements or incentives for bicycle parking?
For bicycle parking, I think we'll be dealing with that in our next meeting when we deal with street sidewalk scapes, landscaping standards, and things along those lines. It's not something that you would find in this specific portion of the ordinance.
Same thing goes for trees or shade in parking lots?
Trees and shading you'll find in also in our next meeting we'll be doing landscape standards.
So the width of the parking spaces, is that in here? And I
the current ordinance requires 10 by 18,
yes.
And the new ordinance has changed that to more of a standard that's used commonly is 9 by 18.
Okay, so it's a standard used more recently, and many of us have trouble parking that. If there's like an SUV and an SUV, I can't get my van in there. So I go to Trader Joe's and I drive around and around because there's like a small number of spots that I can fit in. So that is, you know, was intended to give the store owners more spaces, but it's created a problem in the parking, and also it creates dings in the sides of your cars when you get them that close. They're not good at 9 feet. Even at 10 feet, sometimes you have trouble getting out, and older people have much more trouble getting out. When you have something like the colonnade, okay, does that have one parking space per person? Because I think they were trying to get away with less than one parking space per person.
One per space.
The residential, or the, I should say, the apartment use in the current ordinance had parking requirements based on the number of bedrooms. Went from one bedroom, two bedroom, and you had different standards for the amount of spaces that you needed. We did some research. We've talked, Montgomery County Planning Commission gave us some information. We also talked to some engineers that are familiar with our land planners, and we did a blanket number of 1.33 spaces per dwelling unit in an apartment complex or in a multifamily situation.
So the colonnade would have 1.33 per residences?
No, I mean, that went through zoning. It's not subject to an ordinance that hasn't yet been advertised or passed. So the parameters that are in effect today are currently what's in the 1996 ordinance, what's been approved by the Zoning Hearing Board.
Okay, so what was approved by the Zoning Hearing Board was less than what was in the ordinance.
And correct. So, that's why it went for a variance.
Well, so what I want to bring this to this forum for is because those people, literally, I heard an earful from person after person about the fact that they have two people at least that drive. They have up to three-bedroom apartments in some cases. So one-bedroom, two-bedroom, they have up to three people who drive. And they don't all drive in the same car because they go to different places to work. So the problem that they had was one space per unit was not enough. And that seems to be what we're allowing. We're actually creating parking problems by letting developers develop less than, you know, what they really need. The other thing was just quickly to go back to the signs, I forgot to mention that the signs that you're allowing, I think neon signs or lit signs in for home businesses in personal neighborhoods.
No. It cannot be internally lit.
They can't be lit?
No. It can be externally. You could have a.
It can't be internally illuminated.
But they can be lit.
You can have a spotlight.
Externally. They could have a spotlight or some kind of landscape lighting on.
Okay. So that changes your residential neighborhoods. So if you live next to a doctor, that's nice. You live next to a psychologist. If you live next to the guy who sells supplies to the Pussycat Lounge, you're probably not going to be quite so happy.
Well, that wouldn't be a permitted business in a residential district.
So, well, I think
it's a professional. It's a professional.
Well, I'm not saying having the lounge there, but you sell supplies. That's a permitted business.
Your home occupation idea would be a professional.
Limited to office.
Not retail is not allowed, but you're allowed to sell over the internet or whatever. If
it's a retail or a wholesale activity.
I'm saying is there are many businesses that are not necessarily something that somebody wants to live next to a big sign and look like they're in a commercial district. It changes.
Well, there's a scale of signs, size, et cetera, you're allowed to. So.
Okay. Changes the character and the nature of our residential neighborhoods. Thank you.
All right. I think
so. In conclusion, our next meeting that's scheduled is for Tuesday, February 10th at 7 o'clock. And our agenda for that, we're hoping this will be our last meeting, and then the Planning Commission will be left to pass along a formal recommendations to pass up to the Board of Commissioners. The agenda that we're slating for that last meeting is to deal with our landscape standards, street and sidewalk scape standards, our green and renewable ordinance, telecommunication ordinance, adult use ordinance, our general regulations, and zoning administration portion of the ordinance, and we'll hopefully conclude our presentations in front of the Planning Commission.
So at that point, could we get the list that I'm sure Mark has been
not at making? The end of that night. That'll be forwarded out to you at a later date.
Right.
Okay. I just don't.
Have to take action? What's
you
the sequence?
You will take action once you've had the opportunity to review the list of things that have come up from this board. And I would
let
say
let them put
to
the
you,
whole document together, and then you will have time.
Allow me several business days to complete that. I'll forward it out to you within the week. And then the board can either plan to address it at their next scheduled meeting, or if this committee wanted to have a special meeting to address and make a recommendation, you could do it there.
Okay, thank you.
Just let us know, because we'll advertise it.
The timing on the Planning Commission's decision to pass along recommendations is both relies on Michael and Mark putting together a list, submitting it to you. Chairman, Planning Commission will schedule a time to discuss those recommendations and changes or anything additional. You can let us know if you, other than Larry and Mark who come to your meetings, and Michael, if you need me to be at any of those meetings to discuss, or that meeting that you're going to have to discuss, that's fine. But that schedule will be dependent upon the Planning Commission themselves.
I have a motion to
adjourn. Thank you for coming out tonight. I appreciate it.
Thank you all.
Thanks, folks.
Have a good evening.
Get home safe.
Get home safe. Watch out tomorrow. Don,
gentlemen,
one second.
Gentlemen?
About tomorrow.